I've always been fascinated by the brain and by what makes us tick. When I was a little child, I was interested in why do people behave the way they do? Why do some people do things differently? As I grew older and my understanding of biology grew more complex or more sophisticated, these questions crystallized into a sort of singular fascination, which is how can a brain, just a big pile of cells, turn into a living, thinking, creative, curious human being? For me, one of the most fascinating aspects of our human experience is our memories. Having watched several elderly friends and relatives succumb to the devastation of dementia, I've learned that memory is important for basic survival, certainly, but also our sense of self, our whole understanding of who we are, is largely founded on our memories. And so as I set out on my career as a neuroscientist, my research question became, how do the cells in the brain work together to create, store, and retrieve memories? And can we restore these processes when something goes wrong? One thing to know about the brain is that its primary mode of operation is through electricity. There's a lot of chemistry going on in the brain too, but the primary way in which the cells of the brain process information and communicate with each other is by sending out little bursts of electricity. For my research, I want to listen in on this electrical activity via fine wires that are implanted in the human brain. I have the opportunity to do this by piggybacking on a medical procedure that people with epilepsy sometimes undergo. So epilepsy is a disorder in which a part of your brain, a small piece of brain tissue, becomes miswired in a way that causes the cells in the brain to become overly synchronized. So they fire together, creating big waves of electricity that are much larger than typically expected in the human brain, which is the physiological underpinning of a seizure. So for people with epilepsy that does not respond well to medication, the state-of-the-art treatment for these people is to try and figure out if we can identify the piece of brain tissue that is causing the over-synchronization to start, because then it can potentially be surgically removed. To figure this out, a neurosurgeon will implant fine wires into the brain areas they think could be problematic. And then, with electrodes implanted, the patients will wait in the hospital for a week or two until they have seizures, and as the big waves of electricity start, their doctors can identify where that's starting and use that to determine their best course of future treatment. For me, as someone who is primarily interested in memory, these electrodes provide us a unique opportunity, because most of the time that the patients are in the hospital, they're actually not having seizures, and their brain is just doing normal brain things, like experiencing their world and making memories of it. So most of the patients agree to let us record and observe their brain activity while they play some games or take some tests, so that we can use that to understand how the brain achieves these tasks. I'm particularly interested in recording from the hippocampus, which is the brain region that is primarily responsible for storing new memories. There are lots of very interesting things that we've learned over the years about how the hippocampus stores memories from listening in on the wires. We've learned how the hippocampus represents ideas and how it brings them back when you're about to remember something. We've learned that we've made progress in being able to predict whether or not you're going to remember something later based on the state of your brain at the moment that you're supposed to be learning it. But what I want to talk about today is actually something that may be even more impressive than what we've learned by listening into the brain, and that's what we've achieved by talking back to the brain. So these electrodes that we use to listen to the electrical activity in the brain can also be used to send electricity back into the brain. And so we wondered whether we could use electrical stimulation in order to give the hippocampus a boost when it's supposed to be learning something and improve the probability of remembering it. To test this, we showed our patients pictures of a lot of people they'd never seen before. And on half of the pictures, just before we showed them the picture, we sent little bursts of electricity into the entorhinal cortex, which is the brain region that is responsible for sending the content of an experience to the hippocampus. We figured that this could help prepare the hippocampus to learn without actually disrupting its own processing. Later, we showed the patients pictures of the people they'd just seen or pictures of people who looked similar to them and asked them whether they had seen the photo before. We predicted that patients would do better at distinguishing the old from the new photos for the items that had received stimulation. Previously, our group and other groups have attempted to use electrical stimulation to enhance memory and have had pretty mixed results. We were using a new and refined method, but we also had mixed results. Sometimes we found that patients did much, much better on the photos that had received stimulation. And other times, the stimulation didn't really seem to make much difference at all. When we looked at the data more closely, though, we realized that our results depended on what side of the brain we were stimulating. When we stimulated on the right side of the brain, the performance was better, was enhanced by stimulation. When we stimulated on the left, it was entirely ineffective. And this actually makes some sense because there's previous evidence in the literature that the right side of the hippocampus is more involved in facial processing than the left. So the big message of the research so far is that deep brain electrical stimulation has the potential to enhance human memory and to change human behavior. But it depends a lot on where you stimulate and probably also when. So there are still a lot of questions. There's a lot to be worked out about the exact location and timing and other best practices for making stimulation effective for enhancing memory. But given the how devastating memory impairments are, memory disorders are, and that there really are no good techniques out there to deal with that, it's a really exciting time to be in the field and developing techniques that show some promise and that we hope will one day be transformative for the lives of people with memory disorders.